It's on. Is it? Yes, it's on. Okay, thank you. So then, we know that if we have a weakly bound level, the scattering length is positive. Then there's another possibility. We can have a closed channel with a level above the threshold, and the model that belongs to that is the model that's given here, where we have here a quasi-bound level and the scattering length is negative in this case. So then, the picture that usually is shown when people discuss Feshbach resonances is a picture of this type. We use an external field, it can be a magnetic field, it can also be an optical field, to move one of the potential with respect to the other. Doesn't really which one you move, one with respect to the other. And in our model, the way I derived it, it is the triplet potential that shifts with magnetic field. So then, we wrote down the interaction between two alkali atoms, because the model, as I showed you so far, was without internal structure. So we have our potential that we started out with for the relative motion. We have the Zeeman contribution, the electron spin Zeeman contribution, and we have the nuclear spin Zeeman contribution. And we found that we have to go to the level of the hyperfine interaction to find a term. All these terms conserve M sub F, but there's the last term is giving a coupling between the singlet and triplet interaction. Yes? Then we wrote down the basis states, a rotational, a state for relative motion, rotational motion, spin, etc. And in the case that we have identical particles, we write the big I and M sub I. In this way, we obtain an effective potential, and this effective potential is a potential of the type that we could solve simply by solving the radial wave equation, and that can be done with our model potential or with any potential of to any sophistication as you wish. But the principle remains the same. Then I gave you two examples, two lithium atoms. In the case of lithium atom, if we have two alkali atoms, in the triplet potential, we have total S is 1. We look at S wave behavior, and there's a least bound level. And that's an important number that we will be using, epsilon 1. And the same in the singlet potential, where S is 0, we again look at S waves, and we have there a least bound level. So all these potentials have bound states. And in fact, if you know all the bound state of those levels, you can invert the problem and obtain an expression for the potential itself. Yes? Yeah. The end over end rotation. No, the atoms. The whole atoms. Okay, then we refreshed our memory by plotting the magnetic Zeeman effect, the hyperfine structure for the lithium atoms, and we recall that this is electron spin up, this is electron spin down. And this is the hyperfine splitting. Then we selected two atoms, for each atom a different hyperfine level. In this case, the hyperfine level F is minus 1/2, and this is F is plus 1/2. M sub F, minus 1/2, M sub F, plus 1/2. That means that the total M sub F is 0 in this example. So in the analysis that I showed you here, and you will see another example later, we have to look at M sub F is 0. Now, what we said is that we looked with L0, that means we look at S-wave collisions. And if we have S-wave collisions, then we can only, because we conserve the angular momentum, we can only couple to molecules with angular momentum zero. We could also have taken LS1, and then you would go from a P-wave for the free particles to a P-wave in the molecule. If you would like to go from S-wave to P-wave, or even to different angular momenta, you would need another term in your Hamiltonian to enable such a transition. But we stick to this Hamiltonian, and you will see that in the example I will give later, that is enough to describe the physics. But there may be other examples where you need other terms. For instance, second-order spin-orbit coupling is often a term that's important for Feshbach resonances, for the coupling. But you only need the coupling strength and in order to determine the width of the resonance. And taking the point of view of the experimentalist, we are already very happy if we can predict where the resonances are. And now I'm going to show you the procedure by which you can do this prediction. Okay. So we have to find all S-wave molecules. And then I showed you these combinations. And then there was, at the end of my lecture, there was a very nice question. And the question was the following. I explained in one of the earlier lectures that if you have bosons, you have to take the sum over all even partial wave. And if you have fermions, you have to sum over all odd partial waves. And now suddenly the situation is different. And the reason why the situation is different is that we now take into account the internal structure. In that first example, I simply said I have two so-called identical bosons or two identical fermions. By identical, I mean those bosons and fermions are both in the same state. For instance, two spin 1/2 fermions with a spin up. M sub s is 1. And then you see that you have a symmetric spin state, and then for the fermion, the orbital state should be antisymmetric. So you have only the orbital partial, the odd partial wave. Whereas for the bosons in the same state, zero spin, then you need the even partial wave. The wave function has to be symmetric. But in this case, we have also the nuclear spin that comes into the game. Therefore, we also, because if we exchange two atoms, we exchange both the electrons and the nucleons. And therefore, in this case, you also have to look at the nuclear spin. And then I showed yesterday that if you have I is 0 or 2, that this is a symmetric nuclear spin state, and that this is an antisymmetric nuclear spin state. And the fact that both cases are angular momenta, the fact that you have here L0 and here L0 means nothing, because whether it's symmetric or antisymmetric depends on the size of the spin. So, yes. But still, the statement that I made, that you pick up this factor of 2 in the cross-section, but you sum only over half the number of waves, even or odd, that idea still holds. And in the relation to the molecules, this is related to a phenomenon that is called ortho-para modifications of molecules. You might have heard this word at some point. Okay, then identify two type of molecules that could have an S-wave. Yes, let me see. This is an S-wave, this is an S-wave, and that means that if S is 0, I has to be 0 or 2, or if S is 1, my I has to be 1. Those molecular states can be found. Okay. This was the hyperfine structure. And then I showed that the hyperfine structure of a molecule is very similar to that of the atom. In the sense that if we have S is zero, there's no dependence on magnetic field. And if I am interested in the location of this particular level, I can plot it in this curve. It's simply independent of magnetic field because it is an S wave. It's S is zero, I mean. And this is the binding energy. I don't know what the binding energy is, but I'm going to measure it. So now, So then, what I've plotted here is the energy of two free atoms. And I know from my Feshbach model when the energy of two free atoms is resonant with the energy of a molecular state, that then I can expect a resonance if there's coupling, and we have an example where we have coupling. Okay, so the energy of the two free atoms is here. It has twice a bigger slope as here because I have two atoms. Then, if I have the triplet, S is one, then I have M sub F is plus one, zero, or minus one, and I have a level splitting due to the hyperfine interaction with the same argument as you get a splitting in the hyperfine interaction in the atom. Then we identified the states by the fact that M sub F had to be zero, so we know that MS should be equal to minus MI. That means it can be zero or it can be one. And that defines the combination of S, M sub S, I, M sub I that you can have. Then you can predict the resonances by looking at the point where the two free atoms are resonant with these molecular bound states. And that means that you predict resonances at those three points. Here you intersect with the singlet, and here you intersect with the triplet. And I showed you at the end this plot where where the full calculation is done, including the coupling by the effect by the coupling. And then you find that here is a shift in the location of the bound state. So the bound state doesn't have a straight line behavior, but it couples to the singlet triplet coupling. And here you see the effect of the coupling term. And then you see that the effect of the coupling term is very local as you measure as a function of magnetic field. There is also a coupling between the continuum and so let me say, this is only coupling between bound states. And I will come back to that point. But there's also coupling between the continuum state and the bound state. And that coupling gives rise to a lifting of the degeneracy at these points. But I'm going not to do that because the width is not very relevant if you're only interested in predicting the location of the resonances. Well, let's have a look. Our Hamiltonian. I'm now going to do the calculation, at least in a sketch, how you do the calculation. This is our Hamiltonian. These are the states. This is H naught. It's the Hamiltonian for the relative motion, and the rest is spin, Zeeman, or hyperfine interaction. So now what I can do for these states, I can calculate the matrix element. So I write down my Hamiltonian matrix, and then you see that this first term, the H naught, is diagonal in this basis. So what did I do? I chose a basis, which is the basis of total S, total I, M sub S, M sub I. Yes? In this particular basis, I know that the Hamiltonian H naught is diagonal because it doesn't depend on spin. although you can have singlet and triplet, but singlet and triplet are both diagonal in this representation because this is the representation where S can be 1 or 0, so it's the singlet triplet representation of my problem. So then this term in the Hamiltonian will give me the energy, and that's the energy of the bound state. And they depend on S, they depend on L, and they depend on V, which is the vibrational quantum number. Because I will have a number of vibrational quantum numbers and then a rotational cascade, and I should write it for the singlet and triplet case. I project out the singlet and triplet case by this projection operator for V. Okay. So then the same thing holds, it's diagonal for the Zeeman, the electronic Zeeman contribution, and for the nuclear Zeeman contribution. For compactness, I wrote down here the case of identical atoms. And then I have to calculate the matrix element of the hyperfine interaction. And you recall that H plus HF minus is the simple one-atom hyperfine interaction. So now let's have a look. Let's look at the spin. I make this term a bit more compact. This gives me my bound state level in either the singlet or the triplet potential. If I don't know it, I use it as a parameter. And in this example, I will use it as a parameter. So I have now two parameters to solve the problem. It's the least bound level in the singlet, and it's the least bound level in the triplet potential. Now we're going to look whether we have more parameters. And we will find one more. Let's have a look. The second term is the energy of the Zeeman terms. This is a field-dependent shift. It's a Zeeman shift. Yeah. And this Zeeman shift is diagonal in this representation. So we say that the sigma of the alpha must be the sigma of the beta. So the sigma is a short notation for this state. Then we have two terms. And let's look at those two terms. Let's first look at the HF plus. The HF plus was a singlet triplet conserving term. That means it's zero if you have a singlet on one side and a triplet on the other side. It's zero for S is not equal to S prime. We also recall from yesterday that the H minus hyperfine was singlet triplet exchanging. Yeah? So that means in this operator, if I stick in a singlet, I get a triplet, and vice versa. So we know that this one, let me see, this one is zero if S and S prime are the same. If I go from singlet to singlet, it is zero because this operator switches from singlet to triplet. So this one is zero if S is S prime. But if S is not equal to S prime, I have two different radial wave functions. Because the radial wave function in the singlet potential is different than the radial wave functions of the bound states in the triplet potential. These are two different potentials. Yeah? So, whereas here I don't show the radial wave function, I don't have to do it here, this inner product. In principle, I could write it down, but because this term is singlet triplet conserving, it means that on the right-hand side and on the left-hand side of my matrix element, I have the same radial wave function. These are the solutions of the Schrödinger equation in the potential well. And we know the eigenfunctions are all orthogonal. All vibrational states are orthogonal. That means the radial wave functions are orthogonal. and the off-diagonal contribution I can neglect. So that means that we reach at a very interesting situation, that we can write down our Hamiltonian matrix. You can say these two bound states are parameters, or they are measured, it's just two levels. If you wish, you can put more vibrational levels. The Zeeman shift we can all calculate. This doesn't depend on the radial wave function, but it enforces that V must be equal to V prime by orthogonality. So the only part where in our calculation of the location of the Feshbach resonances we find the radial wave function is in the coupling term. Now I tell you a short story. Because when we started the measurement, as usually, we didn't know what the Feshbach resonance was. So we had to find out what the Feshbach resonance was. And then after some time, we came up with this model. It's called the ABM model. Now, you see here the radial wave function. So you must know the potential in order to fill in the radial wave function. So my PhD student, Tobias Tieke, came to me and he said, Joke, what can you say about these radial wave functions? And then you find something very characteristic in physics. Yes. Never ask your thesis advisor. Yes. Because what I said is, Tobias, look here. You have two potentials. One is like this, yeah, and the other one is like this, and you have here the bound states. How do you ever think that the overlap, if you compare such a bound state with such a bound state, can be something else than close to zero? Yeah? That was my response. But Tobias was very happy, because he said, if it's zero, then it drops here out, and then I don't need any wave function in order to find the energies of the states. So Tobias was very happy, yes, but he couldn't fit the data. And why? Because he had to follow this course, and by that time, I had not made this course, yes. But you have all found the course. So there can be a reason, but because Tobias came back and he said making this zero doesn't work, but if you can make it one, we can also get rid of the radial wave function, and I can also solve it, and I don't care whether it's zero or one, and I have the solution. So the answer is, it's one. And now my question to you is, why is the overlap one? And if you followed the course, you could know the answer. Near Feshbach resonance, are you deeply bound or are you not deeply bound? Not deeply bound. We always talk about weakly bound states in the continuum, or weakly virtual state, or quasi-bound state, all close to the threshold, because that's where the scattering length is diverging. What can you say about, you gave an answer, so I'm now going to continue with you. What can you say about a bound state wave function close to the threshold?
It's almost a free.
What?
It's almost a free wave function.
It's almost free like a sine. Well, at large distance, all wave functions look at the sine, isn't it? So the answer is not wrong, but we are looking for something else. Can you say something about the bound states? No, it's only a sine if it's in a continuum, and we're talking bound states, yes? So it's not a sine, it's an exponentially decaying curve. Can someone help? If we have a weakly bound state, it's only very weakly bound, what can we say about the weakly bound state. Yes, it's a halo state. If it's weakly bound, it's a halo state. So I can forget, I can work with the zero range potential because the wave function, where the wave function is significant, is outside the region where your potential well is. And then it doesn't matter whether you have this potential or this potential. These are exchange potentials. They drop off exponentially, except for the van der Waals tail, yeah? Which means that they both have the same van der Waals tail. That means that you expect the same type of halo state for the bound state. And if you have the halo state, and the halo state is the same for the singlet and the triplet, then this overlap is unity. Yes? Okay. This is called the Frank-Condon factor. And let's take for the time being that this is unity. Then what I have to do is I have to diagonalize my matrix, my Hamiltonian matrix. Now, let's have a look how the matrix looks. I have a triplet part and I have a singlet part. This is a 3x3. And you have the HFF plus conserved singlet triplet. So it acts in this part of your matrix, couples the state here. And but it doesn't couple you to the singlet. And you have the H hyperfine minus that couples singlet to triplet state. So it's these off-diagonal blocks. And then I have this for given V, and if I continue, I have the next vibrational level. And the story repeats. And then it depends on the type of molecule that you have, how many of these vibrational levels you have to take into account. If you take an atom like cesium, then you have a very heavy atom, and it means the vibrational level spacing is small. And then you have to take into account quite a few bound states. But if you have a combination of involving at least one light atom, in the example I will give, it's the lithium atom, then you have a light atom oscillating. That means the vibrational level spacing is large. And in those cases, you only have to take into account one vibrational level. Maybe two, if you want to do very accurately. Okay. Is this clear? And so what is now the answer if we do the diagonalization of this matrix? I won't do the explicit diagonalization because I'm aware that we all can do diagonalization, yes? The way I do the diagonalization is like this. I push the button diagonalize in Mathematica, yes? Is there anyone in this audience who does it differently? No. So we all push the button in Mathematica. Good. We shouldn't lose time in things that Mathematica does. And it does it very well, let's face it. Okay, so it means we can diagonalize this, and you see I've chosen a basis that consists of bound states, only bound states, singlet and triplet bound states. So after the diagonalization, I end up again with bound states. If I make linear combination of bound states, I end up with bound states. But these bound states are no longer pure singlet or triplet potentials states, but I can be mixtures. So that means if you look as a function of magnetic field, the singlet-triplet ratio can change because of the magnetic field dependence of this matrix. Okay, so now we found three fit parameters in principle. Yeah, it is this Frank-Condon factor and the two energies, the least bound state in the triplet and the least bound state in the singlet potential. The Frank-Condon factor. So let's look, I already made the argument, but let's look a bit more in detail. This is my, these are my triplet, the red one, and the singlet potentials. Here I have the exchange radius. That's where you start to see a difference between the singlet and the triplet. That's determined, that's the, where the exponent is negligible with respect to the van der Waals tail. And this is the range of the interaction, and this is the van der Waals range, and we derived this expression for the van der Waals range. We didn't have to factor 1/2, but it doesn't really matter. You see, it's a quartic, 1/4 root. How do you call it? 1/4 root. Is that the quartic root or whatever? It doesn't matter. And this is the C6 potential for the van der Waals interaction. So, if we have hollow states, we are in a universal regime, we are weakly bound, then we can write down the wave function here. Yeah? And then we can calculate the van Kondon factor. And then you see that the wave function is simply a decaying exponent, e to the power minus kappa 1 r for the triplet over r. And for the singlet, I get a similar one containing minus kappa naught, r over r. So this, the overlap we can calculate. We have these two wave functions. We should integrate over the wave functions. And what you get out is an analytic result for the overlap. And then you see that the overlap depends on the binding energies. And you also see that if kappa 0 equals kappa 1, this is kappa, this is 2 kappa, and the overlap is unity. So what you find is that the overlap is only unity if the energy of the least bound level in the singlet potential equals the energy of the least bound level in the triplet potential. So in our experiment, we were lucky that it became unity because that happens to be in the case that we were investigated. And let me tell you, luck is part of the game. Okay, but it can be that you're not dealing with hollow states, but that your states are what is called asymptotically bound. That means that the turning point, the classical turning point of the state, is at a point where the exchange interaction is negligible, but at a point where you no longer have a short-range interaction. So it somewhere in that region. Then you can do the same calculation, and you can, in order to calculate the van Kondon overlap, the only thing that you have to know is the van der Waals tail in order to compare the two wave functions. Because on the inner side of the wave function, you will always get the same turning point, to very good approximation, and you can even correct for the small difference. And on the other side, you have the same potential, and so the character of the van der Waals interaction completely defines the van Kondon overlap. But we can equally well think through the system as a system where you can simply set it unity. And here I show you the plot. For the two potentials that we were dealing with, the bound states, you see here, you see the deep well, which is the singlet, and you see the shallow well, which is the triplet, for the case of the combination of a potassium and a lithium atom, lithium 6, potassium 40. And then I've plotted here the two bound states, and you see here the wave function oscillate. But really, here you have large areas where you have a substantial probability. This doesn't contribute very much to the probability of finding the particles. So if you look at those two least bound states, you're not surprised that if you take the overlap, it's close to unity. So in this particular case, we only need 2 fit parameters. So in this particular case, we can fit the resonances without knowing the radio wave function, and that's really something. You know, we were doing this modeling ourselves because you cannot talk to theoreticians if you don't understand a bit about what you're doing. You have to understand at least a little bit about the problem in order to formulate in a coherent way your question. Yes? So this was our language. Yeah? And of course, we were not only interested in the position of the resonances, but also in the width. And for the width, you need the theoreticians, because they calculate the coupling of the bound state with the continuum. So that gives rise to the splitting of the, you know, the dashed pair, where we have the dots, and the lifting of the degeneracy there comes from a more complicated calculation. It's called coupled channel calculation, or close coupled calculations. You will find those words in the literature. Okay, so I will come back to the point where we contacted the theoreticians. So let's look at the experimental case. Lithium 6, a fermion, potassium 40, also a fermion. Yeah. Here's our Hamiltonian. Now we have for the the radial part, I mean the relative motion I don't discuss. H naught I leave out. The Zeeman energy is in here, and the hyperfine interaction is in here. But these are not identical fermions. These are different fermions. They're distinguishable by their mass. So this is our Hamiltonian. And then we should look how the atoms look. Lithium 6 we already saw, and potassium 40 is like this. In the case of potassium 40, you have a large nuclear spin, and the electron spin for all alkalis is 1/2. And you see it looks different. And the reason why it looks different than this curve is because here you have a so-called inverted hyperfine structure. You know, here you have a positive nuclear gyromagnetic ratio. In this case, you have a negative gyromagnetic ratio. A negative gyromagnetic ratio means that the charge rotates like this, and the spin points in the other direction. Normally, what you think is that the rotation of the charge is directly related with the direction of your spin. But actually, that's not the case. And does any one of you, it has nothing to do with Feshbach resonances, but does any one of you know why? Well, in the nucleus, there are also neutrons. The neutrons do not carry charge, but they have a spin. So it can be that the spin, if you have a very large spin, and here you have a spin is 4 for the nucleons, it can be that the spin, the sum of the spins of the neutrons determines, dominates the total spin of the nucleus, and then you can have this inverted situation. And that's what's happening here. But as in all these hyperfine structures, the state with the highest multiplicity is shifting in the region, positive or negative. If it's positive, it shifts up. If it's negative, it shifts down. But but if you look at the G factors, the state with the largest multiplicity always has a positive G factor, and it has a negative G factor if you have the smallest multiplicity, all for spin 1/2. So this holds for all the alkalis. In this respect, the two are the same. And you can check this statement by looking at these levels. But that's an aside. Now we have lithium 6 and potassium 40, and we have to put two atoms. There I put the atoms. One atom of lithium in the ground state, and one atom here with an M sub F is plus 1/2. And the second one is a potassium 40 atom with an M sub F equal minus 7/2. Yes? So it means that my total big M sub F, if I add the two, is minus 3. In the first example, I gave you MF equal to 0. Now we have to deal with MF equals 3. That is, okay, that's just another one. But you see how wonderful that MF is conserved. How many levels do I have there? If I didn't know that MF was conserved, I would have to look at shifts, all possible shifts between all those hyperfine states. I know that I can never couple to those other states because there's no coupling term in Hamiltonian. I only can focus on one M sub F state. It's a great simplification. Okay, let's now look at the measurement. This is the energy versus magnetic field, and this is the energy of two free atoms. In this case, it's the potassium in the minus 7.5, lithium in the plus 1.5. Okay. So now, if we do a measurement, then we can look at the so-called loss feature. What happens? We shift the magnetic field, and that means the potentials shift with respect to each other. That means at a certain field, the system will become resonant. You know, near the resonance, the scattering length will start to diverge, and that means you become vulnerable for having a collision between two atoms in the presence of a third one. And that means you can have free body recombination and you lose your particles. And that means here we simply fill a trap with a mixture of lithium and potassium, and we keep it there for some time, and we look how much is left after a certain time. And then you see that at certain fields, you lose particles. And there are certain fields where you don't lose particles from the trap. And here you have narrow features, here you have a broad feature, broader feature. Of course, now you have to be careful, because if you have a lithium-potassium mixture, then it can also be that there's Feshbach resonances between two potassium atoms or two lithium atoms. So aside from the lithium-potassium resonances we are interested here in this context, there's also other resonances. And there's also an example here. This is such a resonance. I don't recall whether it was lithium or potassium. It doesn't really matter at this point. So what we expect is that if we do our calculation, that we will find resonances at these three fields. So what is now our task? Our task is to push the button in Mathematica, and we get out all the bound states. And this is the answer that you get for this particular mixture. So you see the field dependence, you see the low field that they repel each other due to the hyperfine interaction. Well, you could talk a long time. These are the location of the bound states. This is the two free atoms. And I've also plotted the epsilon 1 and the epsilon 0 in this plot. So now, where do we expect the resonances? If I look at this plot and I measure up to 400 Gauss, I expect three resonances here. Yeah? That's where I expect my Feshbach resonances. But at that field, I should have shown a little bit further. In that field, there's no structure. So that means that apparently the value that I chose for epsilon 1 and epsilon 0 is not the correct value. Because here I have three levels. So this trio I can produce by shifting our trap a little bit more, because not the trap, the potential a little bit more. Because I'm looking at the bound state. And apparently my estimate for the bound states in singlet and triplet potential was not good. So what I do is I shift the potential of the singlet with respect to the triplet, and then I can make these peak match my molecular states. But you see there's two peaks that are not on there. And and then, of course, when we had this result, well, we were wondering whether the model was too simple or whatever. Yeah. But then we thought it need not be a P-wave resonance, because the measurements that we did was not in the ultra-low temperature regime. There was a thermal cloud where it also had a fraction of P-wave collisions. So we were wondering, could it be that there's a P-wave contribution here? And that you can estimate. Because what I've plotted here is the rotational shift. We simply know that it scales like L times L plus 1. We get a rotational barrier. We turn from the red curve to the blue curve. And that means that you immediately realize that this level will shift up, and it will shift up by a certain amount. And that amount you can accurately estimate if you know these radial wave functions. So, and these radial wave functions you can estimate in the region where you only have the van der Waals interaction. So this correction term can be calculated, and you don't need you need a potential curve, but the theoreticians that studied the system had potential curves, so you can calculate these wave functions, and from that on you can calculate the rotational shift. So let's now look at this effect. If we shift the curve to this amount, we get the singlets, and if we shift further, we get here the resonance with the two triplets. I recall that we were at a conference. There was the Saint-Ferlieu conference in the BC conference in Oshawa, in Saint-Ferlieu, and we were there. There was Rudy Grimm. There was Tobias Tieke, there was Sefas Korkomans, and I was there. Yeah. And Rudy Grimm had measurements, we had measurements, and Rudy Grimm had his measurements already almost half a year in the cabinet because they couldn't fit it. And there was a collaboration with a very famous physicist who's called Paul Julien, who calculates these things. And Paul had been working on finding the resonances for half a year, but it took him a lot of time, and he couldn't find the resonances. I never forget that we thought this must be the case, so we identified this as P-wave resonances and this as S-wave resonances. And we wrote in the evening an email to Paul Julien, and you know in the US, it's 6 hours later. When we woke up, Paul Julien, on the basis of this input data, had calculated all Feshbach resonances, inclusive width, and the problem was solved overnight. And then you see how the input of an experimentalist can make a difference. We don't know so much about Feshbach resonances. Paul Julien knows much more about it. He knows that you can have all kinds of situations where you have unexpected couplings and whatever. And he has a program that takes care of all these eventualities. He has many coupled channels. And because of this, the input information that you need in order to do the calculation already has to be very accurate. Otherwise, the program doesn't converge. And in our case, we could give this input. He could check it, and he had the answer overnight. It's a wonderful example of an interaction between experimental and theoreticians. We all had fun, and we celebrated, of course, as you can imagine. Okay. Yes. the relation to the scattering length. What I've shown for lithium potassium, what you get at the end of the calculation, if you do not vary the energy, but you vary the magnetic field. In the experiment, you need a knob, and the knob is the magnetic field. You do not vary the energy directly. So here you find the scattering length as a function of magnetic field, and here you find the corresponding bound state. And you can read now these plots. Of course, this is a measure for the location of the resonance. You shift the resonance. And then you see that at certain fields, you find the resonance, the divergence of the scattering length. If you look closely at the bound states, close to the threshold, you see this: the bound state shifts to the threshold, and close to the threshold, it becomes universal. And I explained to you this curvature close to the threshold in the first two lectures. So you see it here coming back. Then here you see a plot, schematic plot of such a resonance. So typical what you have a central field or a B field or energy if you like, and here you vary the field or the energy. And so this is the resonant contribution to the scattering length. I should say that this is zero scattering length. And if you look in this plot, you see here a level that is non-zero, but also non-resonant. That's called the background contribution to the scattering length. In our model, that was the R0. You know, we had the R0 contribution plus the resonant contribution, where R0 was the range of the interaction. Here you also have the background. Here you have the resonant contribution. So the idea is now to write a resonant contribution in a way that it can describe this divergence. That means it should go proportional to epsilon B, the energy, minus epsilon naught, which is the position of the resonance, the divergence. And then we need a width, and you recall that the parameter that defined the ridge width was the R star. It was the width parameter for narrow Feshbach resonances. But you can extend it all the way to the case to have the Breit-Wiedner resonance. So now we have to replace these energies by magnetic field. And of course, that is nothing else than a shift in magnetic field, because the Zeeman shift is linear. Then I have introduced the units, yeah. And here this is the effective magnetic moment, because what we are doing is we are shifting the two potential with respect to each other, singlet with respect to triplet, and that means that the field shift that you observe is given by the difference of the magnetic field shift of the singlet and triplet contribution. So that's what we mean by this effective potential. So now we have to add to the resonant contribution the background contribution. Then we get this form. Now there's a famous way in which this equation is always rewritten. But it's confusing, and that's why I explain it in some detail. Look at this equation. What you can do, you can pull out the A background out of this equation. A background, 1 minus the correction term. That means that here, in the numerator, I have to divide by the background. Yes, it has to drop out if I multiply it. So I get that expression. If you do that, then you can write the magnetic field dependence of your scattering length as the background contribution times 1 minus what is called the pole of the resonance divided by the deviation from the center of the resonance, B minus B0. And you see that this delta is given by the quantity that's given here, and it depends on the reduced mass, the background scattering length, the effective magnetic moment, and our star. Well, have a look at this equation. What I showed in the previous lecture is that the R star, or that the width of the resonance is proportional to 1 over R star. I should say the strength of the coupling is proportional to 1 over R star. So that is the coupling between the open channel and closed channel. That's really the coupling strength. But it gets contaminated here. So this is more than just the coupling strength. You might say if this number is big, I have a strong coupling because my resonance will become broad in magnetic field. But that need not be the case because there's also here a dependent on the effective magnetic field. And the answer you get for the delta depends on the background. So that means if your background is small, you get a very large delta. And if your background is large, then you get a small delta. Whereas the actual coupling is the same, because the R star is the same. So this is... This is a nice form because it fits very well in a physical review letter for one formula where you're allowed to put one formula. But it has to be used with care. Okay. So To look at this in detail, if you want to go beyond the model that I've presented, there's a wonderful review paper by Chen Qin and collaborators, and that's why I put it here. Okay, so here I show again the essentials of the Feshbach resonance. You see here the background value, the divergence, the width in magnetic field, and the definition of the width in magnetic field. Now, let me see. What you can do is rewrite. You can define a parameter that defines the strength of the interaction. Yeah? What people do in this review paper is define the S parameter, and the S parameter is a measure for the strength of the coupling. And usually they define the S parameter in this way, but you should realize that it's nothing else than the ratio of the range of the interaction and the R star, so the width parameter. Okay. Here you find values. Here the S is plotted for different examples. And then you see that the magnetic width of the resonance can vary a lot. It can be very small. Here, for instance, here in the cesium, sodium here, or it can be very large in lithium. You see in the case of lithium, you have narrow and you have broad resonances. So it means that by choosing your resonance, by picking out your resonance, you can make use. If you're interested in a wide one, you can pick it, or if you're interested in a narrow one, you can pick it. Usually, it's not difficult to find narrow ones. Usually, it's very difficult to find big ones. And this is the parameter. And here, in the case of lithium 6, you find the example of a very big one. In the case of lithium 6, you see I go here from 600 to 1,000 Gauss, where you observe the Feshbach resonance, the effect on the scattering length. This is to study the BCS crossover in a two-component Fermi gas. And this is the center of the resonance. You see it's extremely broad. And from an experimental point of view, that's of course nice. Because if you have such a broad resonance, it means that the magnetic field cores that you have to produce do not have to be very accurate. If you get the field up to 1 Gauss or a tenth of a Gauss, which is not too difficult, you get a very accurate field. Of course, if your resonance is less than a millicauss, and those resonances are being studied, then you need a field stability that's much better than a millicauss. You need field stability at the level of microgauss, and there's also people working on those things. And then the magnets become much more sophisticated. You have to do all kinds of shielding, it becomes complicated. This was the first one that was studied in the Fermi gases. Then look at the effect. So I can now use the Feshbach resonance to change the interaction. And I showed you in the third lecture, the difference between the collisional properties, the kinetic properties, and the energetic properties. And and you see, if you have a positive scattering length, you have an effectively repulsive interaction, and that's what you see if you look at the clouds. Here you see the Feshbach resonance. It's here measured at the positive side of the Feshbach resonance, and that means that is where the scattering length is positive. And you see if you move up this curve from higher field to lower field, what you see is that the repulsion increases and your cloud becomes larger. So you see that this effect of the repulsion can be observed directly in experiment by making a photograph. So from studying these profiles, you can get information about the scattering length. In this way, you can measure it. What you also see in this curve is that there's no measurements on the other side. Who knows why? What? It's unstable. If we are on the other side, the scattering length is negative. That means we have an effectively attractive interaction. And that means the condensate tends to contract. And although you can, to a certain extent, still measure it if you don't have too many particles. In practice, it means a collapse and the measurements are very difficult. So here you see, for that reason, there's no measurement on that side of the resonance. Very simple demonstration of the power of Feshbach resonance. And every time I see these things, it's absolutely amazing that you can do this. Yeah, It's a great gift to our field that we can tune the interaction. But in order to do that, of course, you need Feshbach resonances, and not all systems have Feshbach resonances. And if they don't have Feshbach resonances, you have to study it without that tool. It's a tool. Okay. Now the Fano line shape. Again, I do here the plot. Background value, scattering length, you recognize it. Magnetic width of the scattering length. This is the scattering length, the offset. Yes. So now we are going to look at the collisions. What is the collisional cross-section? These are not identical particles. So we have here 4 pi a squared for the elastic cross-section. Yes. So that means from this curve we can go to the elastic cross-section by taking the square of this scattering length. And now it is important to realize here the scattering length is positive. You come here from divergent and negative. And that means, and you go back to the background, that means it's essential that if you have an offset, there's always a zero crossing. You cannot avoid it. And that Zero crossing defines the profile, and the profile is called the Fano profile. I simply square my scattering length, I get a divergence, and you see here that the line becomes very asymmetric, and here you find a zero point, and here it goes back to the background value. So now the question is, how can we measure this? Oh, that's one more thing that I should say. You recall that the scattering length is the value that you obtain for the phase shift in the limit that the energy goes to zero. In the experiment, you will not do the energy. You will not have the energy going to zero. That means that you will be limited by the finite energy, which is the 1 over k squared term in front of the cross-section expression, the unitarity limit that I explained to you. That means that you have to start broadening your resonance. First of all, let's say that you're really at t equals zero, at zero energy, and then you have the blue curve. Yeah? Let's now look at a mono-energetic collision at higher energy, no temperature distribution, only one energy. Then the resonance is shifted, yes, because if at zero energy I work here in the threshold, at finite energy I will be working here. That means the point, the B field where I'm resonant in this case will be different than the B field where I'm resonant if I'm working at that energy. It means I have to shift my magnetic field a little bit. And that's what you see here. Then what I can do is average over the energy distribution in my Fermi gas. And then I show it here on a logarithmic plot. And then you see that as k goes to zero, you have this beautiful divergence. But if you go to finite temperature, for the type of temperature that we were using, you see your structure is broadening, and in fact even the zero crossing will shift a little bit. Do you follow this plot? Yes? So the thermal average is smaller. So this shows you that if you are at finite temperature, you don't observe the resonance. Now, so then you can do the thermal average value, then you get this shape of the final shape of the resonance. And I remind you of the unitarity limited scattering, where you have this, where you have the 1 over k squared dependence. Okay, now I should say something about the width. There's two ways in which people discuss narrow resonances and wide resonances. In fact, I've written here three. So it can be broad in delta. That means the magnetic width of the resonance is large. Then people call it a broad resonance. It looks broad if you measure, but it's not really a physical quantity. It can also be broad if you compare it to the band of energies that you're analyzing, like in the previous example, in the Fermi gas. In the Fermi gas, you have energies up to the Fermi level, and it makes a big difference whether you have a broad resonance or a narrow resonance, because if you have a broad resonance, in the sense of this condensed matter context, if you have a broad resonance, you say that all my atoms within up to the Fermi level feel the same scattering length. In that sense, it's then broad. But it can also be that the width of the resonance is narrow as compared to the Fermi distribution. And then of course it changes the physics considerably, because only part of your fermions will be resonant, and depends on the magnetic field which part of the field you will be probing. You can be probing near the Fermi surface or probing deep inside the Fermi field. And the third way of the meaning of broad is the Feshbach coupling. And broad means a large R star. It means a strong coupling, a small delta function in the model of potential that we've seen. This is the coupling in the sense of, let's say, quantum mechanics, if you couple two levels, etc. So watch out if you see the word coupling, in what context is being used, or broad, or in what context is being used. Okay. Now, to finish my lecture, I show you the experimental results, and many things come together from what I explained to you. We did these experiments with lithium and potassium, and in optical trap. And so you see, we had something like 4,000 lithium atoms, and something like 20,000 potassium atoms. Because we both atoms are in the same trap, we have a difference between the laser. Gives rise to a different polarizability of the atom in one case or the other case. So in the case of potassium, the trap is deep. In the case of lithium, the trap is shallow. Now, how can you measure the cross-section? Or how can you measure the Feshbach resonance? How can you measure the line shape? It's done in the following way. And in fact, it's very simple. What we do is we reduce this potential from the value U naught to 50% of the original value. What will happen? You see that these red ones, which is the potassium 40, they are very deeply trapped. And the lithiums are less deeply trapped. So that means if you reduce the height, you will start to lose preferentially the lithium atoms. But how can you lose lithium atoms from your trap? Because in order to lose particles, and that was explained by Philippe, you need collisions, you need evaporation from your trap. How can that be? Because if you have lithium 6 in one hyperfine state, and potassium 14 in one hyperfine state, then you have the situation of identical particles, identical fermions, where we know that in the S-wave regime, they do not collide. Yeah? So that means that individually, the lithium 6 do not collide, and the potassium 40 do not collide with each other. Of course, the lithium 6 and the potassium 40 are distinguishable, so those collide with each other. So there's S-wave collisions between the lithium and potassium. We know how to calculate the cross-section. It is the 4 pi a squared. And we have the formulas, and we discuss the resonances. Which means that and we also know that the rate of loss goes proportional to the elastic cross-section. In evaporation, it means that we have a measure for the cross section by studying this evaporation as a function of magnetic field. And then what we expect is that there will be a region of fields where we have strong evaporation and a region of fields where there will be no evaporation or slow evaporation. And this is my last sheet, the characterization of the Feshbach resonance. Here it all comes together. What you see here is the the number of lithium atoms that I have in my trap after a certain time. You see, there's no loss here. There's some loss here. There's a little loss there. But if you keep them in your trap longer, what you see is, well, first of all, you see here a loss. Yeah. So this is a clear measure for the resonance. But if you now look closer, then you see that after a longer time, it broadens, but it also becomes very clearly asymmetric. Now you can use the expression for the Fano Lie shape to determine the location of the resonance. And then you see, if I go back to this plot, what I call the center of the resonance is, of course, the point where I have the divergence. But the point where I have the divergence, that's not the point where my cross-section has its maximum. If you look at the maximum of the lost feature, you do not see the center of the resonance. You need to know the Fano profile in order to decide where the center of the resonance is. Okay, I think that is the message. Thank you very much.
There is only flashback resonance for fairness.
What?
There is only flashback resonance for fairness.
No, no. In fact, the question is, are there only flashback resonances for fermions? No. Because also if you have bosons, you can have two alkali bosons, you have singlet and triplet potentials, and that means you can do the same game as I did with those potentials. There's bound states, the whole thing repeats itself, also with bosons. But for fermions, the Feshbach resonances are particularly valuable. And I'll explain, maybe I should have explained this in the lecture, but it's beautiful. Let me first tell you the story of the first Feshbach resonance that was observed. The first Feshbach resonance was observed by Wolfgang Kettle. I think it was still before the turn of the century. And it was done with rubidium, boson. Now we also know that there's two sides of the resonance. Yes, there's the positively tuning where the scattering length is positive, the scattering in a region where the scattering length is negative. What Kettle observed was that when the scattering length became large, he had very large losses and he lost his sample very rapidly. Then he contacted the theoretician, that was in this case Boudewijn Vergaar. And Boudewijn had done these calculations, and he was very excited that this phenomenon was observed, and he asked Kettle whether he would like to have a look at the other side of the resonance. But Kettle already had taken apart his apparatus and was going on to measure something else, and on that moment, the reputation of the Feshbach resonances was the following: if you meet a Feshbach resonance, run. Then came the fermions. The fermions are something very beautiful. Because if you have two fermions near a Feshbach resonance, the scattering length becomes very large. And now you expect rapid recombination if you put a third fermion in the neighborhood. Yes? But the third fermion must be either of the same type as one, or of the same type of the other. And you know that two fermions cannot be simultaneously at the same position. So in the case of two-component fermion gas, three-body recombination is completely negligible. It's suppressed by the Pauli exclusion. So. So that's, you asked for the bosons, but this comes with the fermions. Thank you. Other questions? Who has, yes?
You write some sort of vector potential in terms of the scattering limits.
What did you say?
Is it possible to write an effective interaction potential in terms of the scattering limits?
Yes, that's what they all do. In all in condensed matter physics, yes, they write the chemical potential. They write G times N. Yes, this is the interaction proportional to A. I derived the equation. Maybe you forgot, but it's a direct relation. This is the coupling. Yeah. Still have time. Never harms to stop a little bit early with the last lecture on Friday, but we have, of course, the presentation still. Questions? Thank you very much for your attention.
Alejandro, Adrián. Arthur Machado Lacerda. Bárbara Andrade dos Santos. Camila. Daniel Reis. Daniel Padilla. Daniel Gonzalez. Padilla Gonzalez. What? You are Raul. Yes. No. Okay. No. I'm calling Daniel Padilla Gonzalez. No, he's not here. Okay. Raise your hand high, otherwise I cannot. Danilo. Davi Bastos Costa. Elnas. Enrique Arturo, Felipe Aaron Pinto, Felipe César Dias dos Santos, Felipe Gelvers, Felipe, Francisca Ignácia, Gabriel Dias Carvalho, Guilherme Costa Matos, Guilherme Tomichio, Gustavo Udri, Hanna Irã Epifânio Júnior, Jamie Alejandra, Lautaro, Loreto Alejandra, Lucas Marcelo Janovic, Maria Paz Camposano, Mariano Uria Valim, Matias Cubillos, Nicolás Adriano, Noel, Otávio Molitor, Pablo, Pedro Faleiros, Raul, Remy, Renan Nunes, Richard de Posada, Richard Escalante, Robinson Dias, Rodolfo Soldati, Santiago Bermudes, Sheila de Oliveira Marques, Tarik, Talita, Ulisses Alejandro Lopes, Vicente Andrés, Dalila, Igor Pará Silva, Igor, okay, thank you.